Hey everybody, today I'll be taking a look at the Castles of Burgundy, which is a game where you will use dice to build your own little kingdom. So, let's take a look. This is the central board. Every player also gets one of these own player boards, which I will tell more about later. Setup is pretty easy, you just put out these tiles. I've set up a three-player game, so I didn't cover up the four spots. In a two-player game, you will also not cover up the trees, and that's how that works. That's pretty easy. You put out five piles of five goods over here, and this is to keep track of the game. So the game plays for five phases, in which each time you will have five rounds. So for the first phase, this will be the five rounds. And you will also randomly determine start player or player order. So in this case, green will go first, then red, then blue. This can change over the game, however, and this gets compensated by these worker tiles. A worker lets you alter a die roll, plus one or minus one. You can also change a one into a six or a six into one. And the third player will get three of these, the second two and the first one. So that's how that gets compensated. So first player will take this white die and roll it, the one. So this good comes at the one spot over here. And then the round starts. Every player will simultaneously roll their two dice. So every player has two dice in their color. They all simultaneously roll. And the first player can take his two actions. So in this case blue, he can take his two actions. He rolled a one and a six. So what can you do with your dice in this game? You actually can choose out of four actions. You can either take tiles from the central board over here and put them on your own player board. As you can see, there are numbers here. And with, so he rolled, I don't remember what blue rolled. Let's say it five and a six, I think. So he can, with his five, he could take one of these tiles over here and put it on his board, and with a six he could take it over here. Like I said, you can alter these die rolls with workers if you have them. So that's one option. He can take a tile, let's say he uses a six to take these two chickens and put it on his own player board. On your own player board you have three spots where you can keep tiles, so you can do this three times without any problems. So that's one possible action. A second option the player has with his die is put out a previously acquired six-sided tile from the central board, so from his personal depot, onto his estate. So when placing to your estate, there are two rules. You have to build adjacent to a tile that's already built, and the number must match with your die roll. So you start out with this central castle tile that's already there. So actually the only available spots right now are over here. And obviously the color has to match, so this boat can only go into a blue space. And right now, only in these two, because they are adjacent to an already placed tile, and you need a 2 or a 5. So actually, if a player had rolled a 5, and he already had this boat in his depot, he can use the 5 to place it over here. And then the ability of the boat happens, which I will explain later. Let's say, same principle, he had rolled a 4, he can use it to put his mine over here. So you can use your die roll to put a tile from your depot onto your board if they also border a tile that's already there. So we already had taking a tile from the central board to your depot, placing from the depot to your personal board, your estate. Third option is shipping goods. So you start out with some goods and you can acquire these goods over here from the central board with a boat. I will explain this later. And what you can do is, you have on your personal board three spots for goods. Now you already start out with three, and if they have the same color, you can stack them. So if you have two orange ones, they only take one spot. Now all these goods have a different number on them. So like the orange ones are the six, as you can see. So you can use a six to ship them, and they give you points and silver. There are these silver pieces in the game, and what they do I will explain in a bit. So third option is selling goods, and your last option is kind of a last resort. You can use your die, the number doesn't matter, just trade your die for two workers. So if you have a really bad roll, or they're just there isn't anything that you really want to do, you can just trade a die for two workers, which you can use later in when it's crucial, you get a certain roll, and that's how the game plays. And that's almost it. So if you look at the player board in the corner, you can see what you can do with your die roll. Take from the central board, place on your board from the depot, ship goods, get two workers, that are your four options with your two dice. And once a turn, you can also use two silver to buy a black tile. It then also comes straight into your personal depot. These black tiles are here in the center of the center board. You can see they cost two silver. So that's what silver is for. And that's actually how the game plays. So like I explained, first you roll the white die, you place the goods. Every player rolls simultaneously. Then you use your dice to take some tiles, place them on your board. When every player has played, first player rolls again white. This good goes over there, and you do play another round, and as this goes on, these goods will show you when the next phase starts, and you do this for 5 phases, 5 rounds. Now what I have to explain is what everything does. When you place something from your depot onto your estate, the special ability of that building happens. So this is explained over here. Now you have castles. They give you an extra die roll of your choice. So when you play a castle over here, you can just take a third action and you can choose which value you rolled. So that's really powerful. Animals score points. So in these light green spaces, you place animals. And this how this basically works, if you play animals of the same kind, they will score more. So if you score 4 pigs, that's 4 points. 3 sheep, 3 points. But if you place again 3 pigs, you will get 7 points, because these 4 from earlier count again. So if you keep placing the same type of animals, this gives a lot of points. Boats, or playing ships, you can take a stack of goods from the central board. So as you can see, after a while, there will be these stacks will start to grow after a couple of rounds. Now when you place a boat, you can take a stack, you can choose whichever one. This one will be nice because they are two of the same color. So you can take a stack of goods with a boat, and you go in turn order one step ahead. So over here, if green did that, green goes over here, and green will be the next star player, then blue, then red. So boats are good for taking star player, and they give you goods, which you can ship with your die roll, and that gives you points and silver, which again, silver is really good for getting these central tiles, for getting more tiles. Next, I will explain the mines over here. So at these gray zones, a mine gives you one silver at the start of every phase. So remember, I told you the game has 5 phases, A, B, C, D, E, and consisting each of 5 rounds. So with a mine, if you get in the first phase a mine, it will give you 4 silver, which is really handy. So mines are very powerful early on because they give silver, and that's really good. The buildings, the brownish tiles are over here, are buildings, and they each have a unique ability. I won't go over it. Some lets them play an extra tile, give you points, give you some workers, give you silver, let you ship goods. So all the buildings have a different ability. And then the yellow tiles are knowledge tiles. They go over here. They are also special, and there's actually, they are all explained in the rules. So the buildings are kind of special, but there are still, every building is 4 or 5 times in the game. And the knowledge tiles are all unique, and they're all explained in the rules. A lot of them offer endgame scoring, so these are some things that once you get it, you can work towards, and it will score you a lot of points. So that is actually how the game plays. There's just one more important thing I didn't mention yet. Also very important is finishing these zones. So let's say you finish this whole blue zone, so you have built the 3 ships. If you're the first to do that, you will get this tile, and as you can see, it will give you 5 points in a 2-player game, 6 in a 3-player game, and 7 in a 4-player game at the end of the game. So these are endgame scoring. The second player will, who finishes a blue zone, will get this tile, so it's also good. And as you can see, these two tiles are for every color. So that's it. When you finish a zone, you get the tile if you did it first, and you will also always get these points over here. So you get, this isn't working great. So as you can see, if it's a zone of 5, you will get 15 points plus these points. So in which phase you do it. So if you finish a zone in phase A, you will get 10 points in phase B, 8, and then 6, 4, 2. So let's say you can finish up a zone of 3 large in phase A. 3 large will give you 6 points, and you did it in phase A, is plus 10 is 13 points. So finishing these zones early on gives you a lot of points for the phase bonus, but also the big zones you will do late. But as you can see, this over here escalates, so it can also score a lot of points. Plus, if you do it first, you get these bonus tiles. So finishing up zones is very important in this game. So that was my overview. Time for final thoughts. I really enjoy this game. It's fun building your own estate on your own little player board. Now I must mention these boards. The game comes with 2, 4, 6 of them double-sided. Now 4 sides are a 1. You can see here the number. And so is it suggested on your first play, you play with every player this board 1. So every player will have the exact same board. But once, maybe you should do that the first game, but starting your second game, I recommend to switch it up. Let's take a look at this one. It's board 9. As you can see, it's totally different. The regions, like this one is interesting because it has here a 6 region and a 6, 2-6 regions in buildings, and that can give you a lot of points if you can fill them up. So it's a completely different look. So once you start playing with every player his own board, which is totally different, this game gets a lot better even. There's also an expansion with which adds more boards. There will be a link up for it now, hopefully, which you can check out. So those boards are really cool. It's fun building your own estate. The interaction in this game is, as you can tell, probably very indirect. It's just grabbing tiles before the other, but you really have to watch each other. Let's say you roll something and you really want, let's say, this church, but you can tell all the other players can't place a church, or they really won't go for it. Then there's no rush getting this. Then you first have to take the tiles in a round, because I forgot to mention this, but when a phase is over, so after 5 rounds, the board gets swept, so all the tiles that are left still laying around disappear, and all new tiles come out every phase. So the tiles that you want, but you're not in a rush to get, you can wait till the final round. Other tiles, you have to be quick to get them. Also with this with these black tiles that you can buy for 2 silver, if there's one that's really good, you have to hurry, pay the 2 silver so you get it first. So there is interaction in that. Interaction here with starting player order, you know, when you see one player building boats, the second will build boats. So play turn orders changes, because going first can be really handy for snatching up those tiles. There's some interaction in getting these first, building a certain color of region first for these bonus points, which can really matter. So there is interaction, but not directly, and there is mostly a lot of looking at each other boards and figuring out what other players are going for and trying to beat them or block them, stuff like that. It's very strategic and tactical. It's very good to have a strategy, like filling up a certain region, going for a turn order for shipping goods, getting a yellow tile, which will give you end points for a certain thing, and work towards that. So there is strategy, but there are also tactics, because you're also always dependent on these 2 die rolls that you get. So you have to work with those values and choosing your tiles, or where you can place, or what you can ship. But So that's tactical. You have to optimize every roll, but so there is some luck. But it's not a very luck dependent game, I think. You just have to make sure you have options, like over here, if you start building in a certain way that you put yourself in a situation where you can only play a tile if you roll sixes or a five, that's making it difficult for yourself. You have to make sure you have options where placing, and give yourself some breathing room. If you make it hard on yourself by playing or building in a certain way, you can make it very dice dependent. But if you play smart and tactical, there are ways around it. And if you really get stuck, like I said, you can always trade in a die for two workers, which will help you later on if you again have a bad die roll. So the dice, they play a role, but it's really not that luck dependent. It's just how you handle it. You roll simultaneously, so the downtime is okay, I think. The fourth player can, or third player can already start thinking, because he already knows his two values. And so there might be some AP and downtime with newcomers, but after a while you really learn to play this game faster. But it's still a pretty, a 2 hour game, let's say, or maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours. I'd say 2 hours, so it's still a longish game. That depends on what you think is long. There's also strategy in your board, by the way. So I mentioned once you go, you switch it up and don't use the one board anymore. This gives you a lot of more options, because like in this one, your starting castle is in the center. You can choose where your castle starts, and then you can look at your board and decide what you're going to do with it. So there's also strategy in that. Minus points. Component quality isn't fantastic. As you can see, the colors are kind of bland, I guess would be the word. It's yellowish and brownish, but it's I don't know. It isn't very bright or clear. It's not fantastic. These player boards aren't cardboard, they're thick paper, I guess. But personally, it doesn't bother me at all. I think the game is pretty, it's okay, the quality is it's decent, it's nothing special, but I don't have a problem with it. But some people would say that this certainly isn't overproduced, it's just decent, nothing special. It's very Euro-y, so if you don't like that, if you want a lot of bashing each other, direct interaction, war, you're not gonna find it here. It's a Euro game. The team is a bit weak, you know, you're building this estate with your dice, but let's be honest, the team it's okay. I actually enjoy it, but it isn't a very thematic game. And there are some possibilities for analysis paralysis. So that are some minus points, but to me, fantastic game, great Euro. You should try it also. It plays great with 2, 3 and 4. It's a fantastic two-player game. If you like playing games with your wife or girlfriend, and it's time to step it up a notch, you've played a lot of gateway games and you want something with a little more depth and length, this is a very good choice, I'd say. So it plays great with 2, 3 and 4. Great game. You should try it. Thanks for watching. See you guys.